So, hi, this is Stu from Love Your Anatomy, and I'm here with Matthew Sweeney in the beautiful Bali. And this was actually going to be my very first interview that I did, but because I messed it up, it's taken us a year to catch up again together. So I'm really pleased to be doing this. And Matthew was also had one of the first articles that I posted on my website. And I was looking at the statistics the other day, the evolution of Ashtanga Yoga, and it's reached about 38,000 views so far. And so anybody that hasn't caught that yet, I'd take a read. And what I wanted to talk to Matthew about today was his approach to Ashtanga, to the practice of yoga and asana in general, and some of his views about the therapeutic aspects, and also about his moon sequence, that type of stuff. So, first of all, perhaps Matthew, I can say to you, we talked off camera a little bit about the fact that yoga needs, or the asana needs to be therapeutic. How do you view that? What do you understand when we say that, and how do you interpret it for the practice?
All right. I see. All right. The word therapy can be maybe a tricky subject for some people, or complicated perhaps. But so my approach, initially is simple enough. The first part of good asana therapy is a combination of the needs of the student's physical body and the needs of their, let's say, for want of a better word, mental well-being, psychological well-being. Those two things aren't all, sometimes they're the same, sometimes they're not. So just to deal with it on the physiological level, if you're looking at any asana system, as far as I understand the ones that I've done, they're all incomplete. None of them can adequately address every single aspect of the body. It's just not physically possible.
Yeah.
So as an asana teacher, therefore, I'm obliged to looking a little bit outside of whatever tradition I'm teaching, if I'm teaching a tradition, or whatever system I'm teaching, in order to make at least an attempt towards being a bit more holistic. And that, to me, is good yoga therapy, if you will, therapy in the sense of trying to be complete.
Yeah.
That lends itself to the psychological, but staying with the physical first. If I'm looking at something like the primary series, and we look at the majority of students who start doing Ashtanga and who persist with it, the majority of those students physiologically won't be able to get past doing the postures in the primary series because they're not capable of certain postures.
Yeah.
And so if you take that statistic, whatever that is, you know, it's my opinion is it's around 70 to 80% or higher.
Won't be able to complete the
primary series for those who started.
Yeah.
And so when that statistic is that high, it means what do you do with those 70% of people? Do you say, oh no, it's devotional, you have to keep doing primary series exactly how it's set, and that's that. Well, physiologically, that's not therapeutic.
Yeah.
It starts, for a lot of those students, most of them in fact, either injuries or boredom, and they stop doing the practice, or they keep doing it and keep getting hurt. From my point of view as a teacher, you're obligated then to look at how can I introduce, whether it's a posture, a different way of breathing, other sequencing, to help the practice be a bit more complete physiologically. So it's not just about, in the primary series, mostly upper body strength and working on the hamstrings. And that's most of the postures in primary are affecting those two areas. So there's not a lot on the quads, for example, flexibility there. And so some students therapeutically would need to work on that, particularly if the hamstring is an issue.
Yes.
And so on. When we can look at different parts of the body and examine, well, what does the primary series do and what doesn't it do, just from a practical, physical point of view. And the areas that it's not addressing for some students becomes important that they do as homework or as another sequence in order to be more complete physiologically.
On the homework side of things, how much can you do, do you feel, inside the practice, confines of the practice, and how much outside of the practice?
Right, and every Ashtanga teacher that I know and every yoga teacher is going to have a very different answer to that. And so, and I think that's how it should be. I'll answer it a certain way, what I think, but everyone else is going to have a different layer with that, and that's how it is. Pattabhi Joyce is going to be saying something, Sharat will say something, and all the teachers, they'll say something slightly different.
And your view?
My view, right, because that's what you've asked. If it's possible, because the student has the capacity, I don't vary it.
Right.
If it's possible. That's usually less than 10% of students.
And would you have a time frame for that? You know, because obviously to start with, everything is difficult, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know? Now some people are just naturally quite good at it. And then what do you mean it's difficult? And they can just jump through and jump back. And it's like, too. Oh, I didn't have to teach you. You could just do that. Fantastic. Yeah. Just like some people, oh, I can do those back bends. Easy, no problem. What do you mean that's difficult? And so some people just have those natural capacities.
Yeah.
I guess the way I look at it is, usually within the first, if someone's dedicated to learning Ashtanga, the first 6 months is pretty tough in terms of, it's hard on the body, not necessarily causing injuries, but it's just a lot to learn and for the body to adapt to.
Yeah.
After that, a sort of a routine is tending to develop, usually in the first 6 months to a year. Some students it takes a bit longer. And from there is where you can start looking at what kind of variations are more appropriate.
Yeah.
You know, for me, for obvious reasons, if I get a student coming in with, let's say, and it's happened a few times, acute scoliosis or acute sciatic pain.
Yeah.
And for example, with the sciatic example, forward bends are an absolute no-no for most of these students. You should not be teaching them any forward bends. And if you're teaching Ashtanga, therefore, if you're going to be traditional, you would not be able to teach that student. You just couldn't, unless you were to go, here's some variations, open up the hips, stretch out the upper back, lie over some blocks, blah, 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 in order to get them a little further so that maybe then they could start doing some salutes.
Yeah.
And that may take a couple of years if you're going to be patient as a teacher.
Yeah.
So in an extreme situation, from the first class, that student needs variation. For other students, the average, let's say, relatively fit and healthy person who comes in, don't need too many variations because it's just a little bit sore in the body, and that's no big deal. You just work through it and you're fine. After 6 months or a year, that may change again. And for me as a teacher, I'm looking out for, okay, are the knees an issue? Are the legs strong or weak?
Yeah.
Are they open in most of the areas we're looking for them to be open in? And if I'm looking at that and seeing, well, is the primary series helping that or not?
Or could they come do something else? Yeah.
And so for some students, it might be a little bit of homework before they practice, just 10 minutes of some quad stretches or 10 minutes of some abdominal strengtheners or 10 minutes of some shoulder openers. And that's sufficient for them to keep doing the standard practice. And so you don't have to change the primary series a lot in that case. For other students, let's say there's a knee, you know, they've been practicing, and as happens with a number of people doing Ashtanga, the meniscus, because the hips are tight, the meniscus is taking the load, and a lot of the joint postures, things like Janushirasana C, Richyasana B and D, all the lotus postures, half lotus, etc., are causing this to be more of a problem. So I'm obligated as a teacher to tell the student you should stop doing those postures.
Yeah.
And that's just a pretty safe.
It can be traumatic for the student though, isn't it? There's often resistance.
They're attached to it.
Yeah.
But if a student's in quite a bit of pain, most students are like, thank God, thank you.
Yes, for giving you permission.
Yes. And then I'll say, not only do I want you to stop doing those postures, here's two or three in the practice that you should be doing to help that open your hips, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Without messing the sequence too much. So my opinion is, if you're going to do the primary series, two or three posture variations is fine, maximum. If it starts being 10 or 20 postures that you have to do to practice the primary, or to use another example, if you have to do a two-hour warm-up before you do the primary series in order to do the primary series, the primary series is inappropriate.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be doing it at all.
Yeah.
It's just, you've got
not
to look
for
at
you.
Something. No. It's, because if it's that difficult, I just don't see the point. You can't. The life and joy and satisfaction in that is not going to be
minimal, isn't it?
Right, and that could be any sequence, whether it's Ashtanga, primary, intermediate, advanced, or doing Bikram or Anazara sequence. It doesn't matter what it is, or even just going to a Hatha yoga class, and if the teacher's doing a strong class, and if you can't do more than 50% of it, well, you're not, you know, it's just...
But I think you like, I think I'm right in saying, you like the structure of a sequenced flow of postures rather than a free flow, more organic, what should we do today sort of thing.
Yeah, I think it's like when I first started learning music as a kid.
Yeah.
And you spend, as boring as hell perhaps, but you spend years and years playing scales, playing other people's music, learning arpeggios, different ways of structures that you just repeat and repeat and repeat. Any classical musician, I'm talking about virtuoso musician, and there aren't that many of them, is that like a really amazing jazz musician can make it up on the spot.
Yeah.
Now, you have to do a lot of training with da-na-na-na-na-na, you know, doing these basic scales.
Yes.
Just like repeating your salutes to get to the point where the virtuoso thing should become natural. My sense of a lot of people who jump into just doing what they feel organically, most of the time, we end up in just doing what we want to do rather than what's
what
actually
need.
Good for us.
Yeah.
So that's the downside of when you vary too much. It means you're not channeled into and challenged on things that are a bit challenging, frustrating, difficult.
Yeah.
And so there's a balance between those two. For someone who only sticks with the set sequence, though, and refuses to do an alternative, shows an incredible resistance, intolerance of change, contraction, and narrow-mindedness. And so someone who's doing the creative sequencing tends to be more open-minded, but not as aware in certain areas.
Yeah.
And someone who is being more focused on the set sequence only is more focused and aware in that area, but less flexible.
Yeah.
So if I use the strength and flexibility idea, or the masculine and feminine, it's the same deal. Someone who's flexible tends to not be so strong and focused, just as a...
While
just as someone who's strong and focused tends not to be so flexible. And so it's challenging yourself. If you really love doing alternatives all the time, that person, the advice is do the set sequence a couple of times a week.
Yeah,
that's good for you. And they're not going to want to hear that advice. Just as the person doing Ashtanga, oh no, I only do Ashtanga, doesn't like hearing, you should be at least once a week doing some variations.
Yeah.
It's good for you, not just physically, but psychologically and spiritually.
And we sort of mentioned this thing about balance. That was one of your therapeutic sort of things as well, the balance between flexibility and strength, isn't it?
Yes.
And that's sometimes hard to achieve without some thought in the practice, isn't it?
Right.
How can we go about generating that strength?
I mean, this is a problem if you're a student and you're going to a particular teacher regularly, and that teacher has whatever opinions on how you're supposed to practice. The question is, my challenge for any student who's listening to this is to go to the teacher and ask them. And if they just give you a line, then my suggestion is seek another teacher. And the line will be, only do what I say, or only do what the tradition is, or only this way. And if you're getting that should and only and this very narrow-minded set view, then it's not going to be therapeutic. I can pretty much guarantee that.
Yeah.
Everything I've learned in psychology and all my experiences has said the only way a teacher is able to actually connect with the student is when you make yourself a human being in relationship, which means you're allowing the student to go to question, to say, look, this is not suiting me. And you go, okay, well, let's see what might suit you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then the teacher might say, okay, I think for now the set sequence is better for you.
Yeah.
That's a different thing than saying, no, just do Ashtanga, that's it.
And we were talking a little bit off camera before we started about, you know, there are certain things in Ashtanga that are sometimes expected, maybe disregarding what is necessarily better for the body. For instance, holding the big toe in Trikonasana, that type of thing. So you have this idea of the rigidity of the training as against therapeutic.
Yeah, the supposition of the holding of the big toe is somehow that it's more energetically correct, and therefore the driving force behind that is somehow that makes it more spiritual. That only if you follow the set sequence are you devotional. which is, it's got nothing to do with devotion, in fact. It's just an attitude that this is right and that is wrong. And those attitudes have nothing to do with yoga. Yoga is about being present in the moment and what is appropriate versus what you think should be.
Yeah.
And so it's those attitudes that I'm, you know, I have them myself, and I'm trying to keep looking at that to go, no, what's appropriate now? Not what the tradition is supposed to be. Because if we fall back on the tradition, we're not being present with the here and now. So if I come to the here and now, and here is a student who is engaged with me and with the practice a certain way, all I can do is look at what they're going through and say, what do I think is most appropriate? And then the student gives me feedback, I'm struggling, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And so my job is to just be able to connect with that without having to rely on my own judgment, or my own judgment of what the tradition is.
Yeah.
And because I have those, and I don't think they're wrong, because that's a part of the learning of saying, well, if you can, yes, good, grab the big toe.
Yeah.
But for some students, physiologically, I would say that is actually inappropriate. No matter how much you say that's spiritual, not that I've seen anyone really injure themselves from holding the big toe, but there are other cases.
Sometimes it puts the body in a really nasty looking position, doesn't it?
Right, and it doesn't create an overall physical effect, talking therapeutically, that we generally say we're looking for.
Yeah.
And so the devotional side is put before the physiological side, which we can see the point of that perhaps, but how appropriate that is, I'm not saying either is right or wrong, but it's worth questioning. Rather than only hold the big toe and you don't question it.
Yeah.
And if you're not questioning it, then ultimately the teacher or the student is not being present. It's just, I'm just doing my routine, and that's and the fantasy is somehow that's spiritual.
Yeah. We were talking to Matthew about this problem with adapting the sequence due to either physical problems with the body or the need for variety for individuals, which is what we're talking about, rather than a sequence that fits all, but something that suits the individuals. And by now everybody knows that Matthew has got the moon sequence and the other sequences. And so I wanted to ask you, Matthew, how did you come about to start thinking why you needed to create them and the creation process, really?
Okay, initially the first part of it was just in my own practice. I had a knee injury that was actually indirectly caused by Ashtanga Yoga because of all the doing four series, essentially.
Right.
But the actual injury itself occurred just mucking around at the beach.
Oh, you're kidding.
So, you know, just one of those little simple things, and I actually went to sit down on my knee. But, both knees had been under quite a bit of pressure from just the kind of practice that I was doing, and for various reasons, the meniscus was under pressure and, torn. And so, post-operation, and once I started getting back into practice again, I'd done a lot of other asana classes, both in Iyengar yoga and Hatha yoga, different things, so I'd had quite a broad exposure beyond Ashtanga already. And so, I used that to just put stuff together, because I wanted to keep up. You know, I was 28, I think, at the time.
Right.
So I was quite young, wanted to keep up a pretty strong, vigorous practice without putting pressure on the knee, and so I put together a few little things. Operation was in 2001 or something like this, around 13 years ago. And I'd been playing with, occasionally when I'd teach other classes, I'd teach different sequences just because I was hired by somebody perhaps to teach a vinyasa class rather than an ashtanga class,
yeah.
So that's what I do, and so I'd already had some stuff I'd been working with, but not really practicing, because I was mostly just practicing Ashtanga. On top of that, I was also, through a friend of mine, Louisa Sear, who was running a teacher training course, and I was teaching the Ashtanga on that, and I was watching a lot of the students, and they had certain days where they were supposed to do Ashtanga, and other days where they would do their own sequences.
Yeah.
Yes. And I started to notice certain themes that the students were all practicing. So when someone was tired, certain postures would commonly creep in.
Right.
When someone was energetic and wanting to do more energy, other postures. And those themes were very common throughout 2-3 years of doing these teacher training stuff. And so that kind of got a little light bulb going. It's really interesting that those themes are very prevalent. And so if you look at the moon sequence, for example, at the time that I started putting that sequence together, I'm not... I can be quite an intellectual person, but when it comes to asana practice, that falls away for me, which is partly why I do asana, is because this mental thing sort of goes away for a little while, which is, you know, a pleasant relief for everybody. And so when it came to designing sequences, same thing. I didn't think about how things were supposed to be. It just, certain things seemed to fit.
So more intuitive.
Yeah, yeah. And I just, this goes with this. And I would just practice it. And then all of a sudden, the flow sort of happened through that. Some years later, like, I don't know, it was 5 or 6 years ago when I first became, I'm quite slow with some things, I first became aware of yin yoga.
Right.
And I'm looking at Paul Grilley's first book on this, and I'm looking at all the postures, and pretty much posture by posture, it's the same sequence. Yeah. The only difference was I'm into vinyasa and he's not so much.
Yeah.
But the ideas of the postures and the ideas of doing a sequence that's not about effort. Yeah. It's about letting go rather than grabbing hold.
Yeah.
The implication of balancing a more Surya practice like Ashtanga with something that's a little more Yin or Chandra based.
Yeah.
You know, it was obvious to me, and after doing it for a while, you know, I couldn't go back. And most students who've experienced it with me are exactly the same, dedicated Ashtanga or not. So it's just about whatever the practice is. What are the different ways we can balance that? And sometimes it's an idea, sometimes it's one posture, and sometimes it's a whole sequence.
And it's not just, I mean, it's called the moon sequence, but it's not just for moon days, is it?
No, and it's not even, I mean, this is one of the things that gets misinterpreted about this, it is not there to replace the moon day.
Yeah.
Most students, male or female, should be having at least one day off around the beginning of the new moon and the beginning of the full moon. Women often, maybe for some, 2 or 3 days off. So for women particularly, that becomes useful, because then if you're taking a heavy period, 2 or 3 days off, one day is nothing, 1 or 2 days is moon sequence, and then back to your regular practice.
Yeah.
For guys, it's a little different. It might be just once every 2 weeks that you're doing this, just because, you know, you're tired or just having a rough day, and the moon sequence is a way to be a bit more tuned in for your body, the way that primary series doesn't seem to hit the same mark, both physically and psychologically.
I'm thinking back a year ago to when we had our last conversation, so if I'm wrong, tell me. But I seem to remember that you were saying that you don't always have, if you're going to have a rest day, and the moon day officially, say, is the Friday, that you might be the day before or the day after, depending on how you feel your energy is responding to that.
So, I mean, in the end, it's not a big deal, but I think it's an interesting way to look at it. In the standard terminology, Rajas and Surya are synonymous. They're the same terminology.
Right.
Surya indicates active energy. Right. Chandra and Tamas indicate the opposite, lower, more declining energy.
Yeah.
Okay, and then Sattva is the rhythm between the two, or between sun and moon, between Rajas and Tamas. Okay, so when we're looking at that then, and you get to something like the moon sequence, and the times of the moon, when we decide before that it's full moon on Friday, just because the calendar says it's full moon on Friday, doesn't mean that's true for you.
Yeah.
Because the way the Chandra energy works, by its nature, it's intuitive. It's not based on what you think, it's based on what you feel. And if you're going to go off what you feel, it has to be, how do I feel today? Ah, today is the day not to practice.
Yeah.
And the way most of the time, because it's simpler for the teacher in Ashtanga to go, Friday is new moon day, that's the day you don't practice.
Yeah.
But for some students, particularly women around where ovulation and menstruation line up with the new moon, which is quite common, one of those, 2 or 3 days before that might be the day you go, not to practice, and it would be wrong for you to practice on that day and okay for you to practice on the Friday.
Yes, yes.
And so if you're going to work with moon energy, it means you have to be intuitive rather than psychological.
Yeah.
Because the Surya energy is psychological, it's here, right? The moon energy is not, it's here. And this is why, my experience, most male teachers don't like this, because we're working another way. And I've had to, you know, I've worked on this myself. I'm not perfect at it, but it's something that I recognize as a man that's challenging. And it doesn't mean as a female teacher you're not operating off that male energy either.
Yeah.
And so it's just being, how do I balance those two off each other? So yes, the moon thing, and the moon days can be inaccurate depending on, because you know if you look at the astrology of it, the different planets line up differently for everybody every week.
Yeah.
And so you can't base your practice purely off the Surya idea of the moon. That doesn't work for the moon. The moon just kind of, you know, sticks its finger up at that.
And if somebody wanted to integrate a more, it's more of a yin practice, isn't it? We're talking about energetically wise, into their every week practice.
Yep.
How could they do that? What would they be thinking of doing
A lot of people do this intuitively, and I know a number of Ashtanga teachers that do actually do this, whether they admit it or not, and often whether it's once a week or once every 2 weeks, for some teachers that means, I just did the salutes, and then I meditated, and then I stuck my legs up the wall.
Yeah.
You know, and that could be the equivalent of, I mean, doing the salutes isn't exactly yin, but it's just, you know, and a practice that's more quiet.
Yeah.
Or for someone else, it might just be shoulder stand, head stand, meditation for half an hour, and stick your legs up the wall. You know, just stuff that's not so physically vigorous, but still, you know, is a dedicated yoga practice.
And could you integrate it, like, I'm thinking about, you know, maybe doing 4 days of a yang practice and so many days of a more gentle...
Some students... And I'll use the gender bias a little bit in this. More women, my suggestion is absolutely every week should be doing, whether it's the moon sequence or something like it, doesn't matter, some kind of yin practice.
Yeah.
Because of the way a female cycle comes about, it's got to be weekly. For a man, it depends on time of your life, age, work, you know, environment, constitution, all those kind of things. Men, I would say once every 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Right. So for women, it needs to be a little, not all, but most women needs to be a little more. The older you are, I think the more of a yin practice you want to be doing.
And you're getting on a bit now, aren't you? So how do you balance your practice?
Thanks.
Not as old as me, I'm afraid to say.
Lucky. My preference is I would tend to do around 4 days a week of a fairly strong, let's say, more yang practice, and 2 days a week more gentle.
And would you break them up, or would you do four, block of four, block of two, or
as
and when?
Yes.
Yeah.
At this stage of my practice life, I'm quite comfortable with that, and I can be disciplined enough for that to work. Initially, one of the things I suggest that students don't do when they first try and integrate something like the moon sequence is, I'm doing that every Friday.
Right.
Because if you're doing that, you're in your head.
Yeah.
Right, and you're trying to keep your routine a certain way, which is a lot of rigidity. So the idea of it is do it when you need to, but still do it once a week.
Yeah. It's going to be hard, isn't it?
Yeah, because people are in there. There's a resistance edge that we want to play with, and that's important. How can I be softer in my practice to balance that stronger energy?
Yeah.
And so the more strong that practice is, the more you need something like a meditation or a yin practice.
And can you tell us a little bit more about the moon sequence that you've devised itself, a little bit more detail about, I think it focuses a lot on the hips and freeing up the shoulders, am I right?
Yes, so the majority of it is on the hips, a certain amount on the back bends, and just it takes the weight load off, both the vinyasa and the salutes and all the postures are geared towards reducing the impact that Ashtanga has on wrists and shoulders.
Right.
So there's some shoulder opening stuff in it as well.
Yeah.
The movements, even though it's vinyasa, it's tended towards going slower rather than going faster. So being a little, each of the movements is slowed down to a point where you can pause with a kind of mindfulness, rather than feeling like you have to go faster and faster to get through it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's supposed to be how Ashtanga is as well, but the tendency is that's not what happens in the first 5 to 10 years.
It seems like a bit of a race sometimes, doesn't it?
And it often, that creeps in without students being aware of it. So when you integrate something like a meditation or slow vinyasa practice like this, it lends itself to then, I didn't notice that I'm speeding up, or my breathing's getting frantic, or whatever it is, and it really helps to calm that down, which brings a level of psychology to the practice that typically is not possible in Ashtanga, not that I've seen or experienced. And so the moon sequence crosses a fence between both Ashtanga style and a yin practice, and also between Ashtanga and a meditation practice, which is meditation itself is gearing you towards stillness and not doing.
Yeah.
And there's no amount of doing in Ashtanga that will ultimately help you to not do until you practice not doing.
And is it how accessible is it? Because we've already mentioned about the fact that maybe the primary series, you know, there's these key postures or cutoff points, right, and that sort of stuff. With the moon sequence, is it?
It's overall, my experience has been it's a lot more accessible for the average asana practitioner than primary series is. Having said that, there are some things in it that are a little bit challenging, and for me, so it should be. Whether it's challenging to slow down, it could be psychologically challenging.
Right.
But also some of the postures can be a little bit challenging. Because it's geared more towards the hips, it's a lot harder to injure yourself with the moon sequence practice than with primary.
Right.
Primary, unfortunately, it's quite easy to injure yourself or to be injured by the teacher, you know.
Yeah.
So for this reason, I really enjoy teaching the moon sequence because students find it more accessible. And so if that means more people can practice it as a teacher, that gives me an advantage. It means I can teach more people.
And
I do.
There's certain personality types, aren't there? I mean, we're drawn to certain types of practices because of the way we are, aren't
we? Right.
And sometimes it's not always the practice you should be doing, is it? You know, if you're a very A-type person, maybe you should be doing more of the other or whatever. Is there a tendency for somebody that's maybe likes a slower practice to drift that way too much? Can that happen?
I think very much it does happen. You know, and so if someone's really interested in a yin practice, they'll be doing yin yoga all the time. Let's say you've got a very busy life, job, kids, family. Yeah. Maybe that's to balance the yang of your life, the yin practice may be perfect.
Yeah.
Just as someone who loves being active and got more of a vata or pitta nature or some combination of the two, they're going to be attracted to doing an Ashtanga. You know, but you don't see many long-term Ashtangis who are full, solid, square constitution.
No.
Right? They can't.
Linebackers.
Right. They're just not going to persist with it because it's too difficult and painful.
Yeah.
Whereas long, tall, skinny, or short, skinny, but either skinny either way.
Yeah.
But particularly long, tall, skinny.
Stop there. Rewind.
Particularly tall and skinny. It really works with the practice, which is a problem because then it means the practice only works better for certain constitutions than others.
Yeah.
So if the other constitutions aren't addressed, therefore Ashtanga is incomplete.
Another favourite, because we mentioned a little bit earlier about the quads don't get a lot of attention in the primary series. So what sort of stuff's in the moon sequence that addresses that sort of stuff?
Well, you know, standard lunges, Ardha Chandrasana, some variations on those, the beginning and end, a whole lot of stuff. People call it pigeon, I call it Vakrasana, you know, those kind of things to work out a hip. So, I mean, I tend to talk about the hips in the four quadrants, four, you know, front, back, middle, side, front, back, side, inside.
We get the idea.
Anyway.
Four sides.
And so the attempt in the moon sequence is towards doing an equal portion on each of those.
Yeah.
You know, some of the back bends are helping to address some of that.
Any sort of lying, like Suptavirasana,
yes,
or that type of stuff?
That's part of it. Well, yeah. I mean, I would consider generally Suptavirasana to be it's one of the more difficult postures.
Yes.
Because it's challenging for a lot of students. Yeah. But there's variations on that posture that students who can't do it for the knees get the same or similar effect.
Yes, yes.
So stuff like that, again, to work that lengthening through the front. A lot of hip stuff. For some students, too much hip stuff. So
Right.
Some of them I would take out if it was still joint issues going
yes.
on. You know, and it can be, anyway, I won't go into it. There could be all sorts of things.
All sorts of
Anything's
stuff.
Possible. So, you know, the moon sequence, like anything, just like the primary series, for some students, less so than primary, but for some students it doesn't work completely. And so I've designed the moon sequence with the idea that it gets modified.
Yeah.
Like deliberately, consciously, rather than that's the sequence, you're not allowed to vary it.
Yeah.
The variations I wouldn't put in the sequence are advanced handstands, 3-hour headstand.
Because it changes the energy.
Yes, it's not, you know, it's got to be postures that are a little more quiet than loud.
And how do the other sequences then fit into this block? So the next one is
the lion sequence. Lion sequence is kind of lies midway between moon sequence, primary series, and intermediate.
Right.
With a whole lot of different postures. So it's actually one of the most therapeutic sequences. I don't even know if I put it together, but that came together.
Right.
It's got a lot of different stuff in it. One example is, one part of the sequence is a whole shoulder and upper back thing. That there's nowhere in Ashtanga that adequately addresses shoulder and upper back. Some of that can be put in the moon sequence as well, so some students just need the shoulder work early on.
Yeah.
And some don't. Moon sequence, as I say, is more targeting the hips and taking pressure off the shoulders.
Yeah.
And for good reason. And, you know, to balance the primary series. Lion sequence is a bit more unique in that we're specifically targeting different areas depending on the student. So for a lot of students, it's upper back work.
Yeah.
For others, it might be open in the upper back, it's working on the hips.
Yeah.
For others, it's other strengthening work, you know, whether it's core strength or something else. And so different things get targeted. I found plenty of students can actually get through primary.
Yes.
Right, the ones who can't, I introduce moon sequence straight away. Or who I think, actually most students doing Ashtanga, I think moon sequence works for in general.
Yeah.
The ones who don't want to do the moon sequence are usually the ones who need it the most.
Yeah.
With the lion sequence, it comes about because of Kapotasana.
Right.
And Kapotasana sequentially in Ashtanga doesn't work too well. Because of the upper back issue. If a student has, I had fairly open upper back and shoulders, so I could do Kapotasana fairly early on. Around 50% or more of students who get to that point get stopped at Kapotasana.
It's a big stopping point, isn't it?
And if we're going to be traditional and can't really grab the feet consistently, that would be the end of their Ashtanga career. They would never go past that posture, ever, in terms of how the tradition is currently taught. Which, again, I don't think is a good therapeutic model.
But there's so much great stuff beyond that as well, isn't there?
It's, you know, and so either you have to introduce a bunch of upper back homework, or you just, Kapotasana, move on.
Yeah.
And either of those work. I think, for me, the great part about when Kapotasana comes up, it usually I'll know beforehand, but sometimes I don't. And when I see a student get stuck on that, I'm like, yay, now we get to work on the upper back.
Right.
And then I'm often then introducing the lion sequence.
Yeah.
I'm saying here, for now, intermediate, we're going to leave for a little while. Yeah. They may not like the sound of it. Some students are relieved. Yeah. Here's this sequence. This is what you need to work on. And it addresses all of that stuff that hasn't been involved in Ashtanga to date.
Yeah.
As far as I know, with the history of Ashtangari, some of that actually did get addressed in terms of how Krishnamacharya would deliberately vary the sequences depending on different themes. It just so happens in the last 40, 50 years since Patabi Joyce and other advanced teachers of teaching Ashtanga that's no longer allowed.
Yeah.
And so that tradition is only 40 or 50 years old, which to me means it's not a tradition.
Yeah.
It's just something for people to hang on to. And so Kapotasana needs variation for certain people. The next one, it happened in primary, but it also definitely happens in intermediate, is all the leg behind the head stuff.
Yes.
And if you don't have long legs, it's going to be often a little hard.
Yeah.
There are some rare exceptions to that, but most students who short legs, again, will probably get to Dwipada and be stopped there for anywhere from 5 to 50 years.
Yeah.
And again, is that really serving the student to go, no, now you have to be devotional?
Yeah.
Or devotional to what? Devotional to the rules is not devotional to God. So I like to question what that devotion means. You know, devotion of kindness to another human being who is suffering through the practice, that's devotion.
That's, yes. There's been criticism often at the moment, you know, that yogis, you know, we can be very sort of judgmental, you know, and is that really, you know, what it's about?
I mean, my personal favorite subject for the last 5 to 10 years of yoga is the tradition of yoga typically deals with two areas and leaves one aside. And the two areas that yoga, as we understand it in the West, one of them, the first one we start with for most people, is the asana practice.
Yeah.
So health for the body.
Yeah.
So we're looking for physical yoga health,
yeah.
Which means holistic physically, trying to open up the body, strengthen the body, support the body. And so that's a great thing for asana to support us in. And sometimes some asana practices really help us with that, and sometimes it makes it worse. If you've blown both meniscuses by pushing yourself through Marichyasana D 5 times a week, you've harmed your body, or the teacher has helped you to harm your body. And that's not good physical yoga. Then we've got the other level of it, which is the meditation yoga, which is incredibly important also. And asana teachers who aren't somehow getting into a meditation practice will never be a yoga teacher. And that the quality of meditation, the self-inquiry, the aspect of both, call it psychological, call it spiritual, part of practice. And that's incredibly important. That's the bottom level and the top level. The one in the middle is all about how we are in relationship to each other as human beings and our relationship to the planet.
Yeah.
And if that's not done with absolute consciousness and kindness and joy, and these two levels can go at the best you can make them, this is just going to keep pulling you back to, whatever shit you've accumulated.
Yeah.
And so good yoga practice has to involve all those three. You're dealing with the body and how you are in relationship to that. You're dealing with other people and human beings and how conscious and kind you can be. I use this word kindness a lot.
Yeah.
I have a little bit of a Buddhist bias, I guess you could say. practice of loving kindness, compassion.
Yeah.
I was asked this in a teacher training course. What's in my opinion, what's the key facet to being a good teacher? And my answer is kindness. It comes before anything else, whether it's anatomy knowledge, yoga philosophy knowledge, even knowledge of your own practice. None of those will make you a good teacher. The important word about being a good teacher is the word good, which means good.
Yeah.
A good person.
Yeah, a good person.
A kind person.
It's more important than putting your foot behind your head, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, right. If you're a kind teacher, and it doesn't mean you have to please people to be kind. That's another thing. Kindness is in your presence, your ability to connect, to be... And kindness can also be pointing out someone's bad points.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's honesty in that, And so I think that's a very beautiful and present-based way to be as a teacher. And from there, yes, you do want the anatomy and the philosophy and the skills with the practice, So I just think how we integrate all of them is critical.
So before we had to pack up, I just wanted to have the chance to ask Matthew about bandhas, in particular Mula Bandha, because I know he has his own views and ways that he likes to talk about this sort of thing. So, fire away.
Okay. I think Mula Bandha is one of those lovely little mysteries that fascinates and attracts people for all the best and worst of reasons, I guess. One of the contradictions that I think appears very quickly in physical-based asana practice is focusing on the lower belly region, and just because we're focusing on the lower belly area, however we're doing that, and equating that with Mula Bandha. I think there's a certain usefulness in asana practice towards strengthening or stabilizing the lower region of the belly. If you want to call that Mula Bandha, fine. I just don't think that's a very accurate description. I think it's a good place to start if you're going to explore something like Mula Bandha. In the tradition, as I understand, of yoga, tradition as I understand it, the three bandhas are also relating to the chakra system.
Yeah.
And so if you're going to talk about bandha with any kind of accuracy, you are obliged to talk about kundalini. And if you're going to talk about kundalini, you're going to have to start talking about samadhi, enlightenment, awakening consciousness. And so to say that holding here throughout my practice of Ashtanga Yoga primary series is Mula Bandha, the implication of that is that somehow, therefore, you've awakened the first lower two chakra.
Right.
By and large, that's not true. And so if it's not true, therefore, it's not Mula Bandha. So... the question comes then, why are so many teachers and students talking about Mullabhunga in the last 10 years?
Yeah.
First 5 to 10 years I practiced, no one mentioned it. So it's something that's become very common in
a focus point.
Focus point for students in something like Ashtanga. And I think the reason is because we're looking to get stronger with things like jump throughs and jump backs and the salutes. And because of the need for that kind of strength, the fancy Sanskrit term for it is Mullabhunga. As I said, I think that's really inaccurate because, yes, it's great to get stronger here and it's useful for your practice to be stable here too rather than just holding this tightly.
Yeah.
So I use these terms, strength and stability, with very different implications.
Yeah.
Because, anyway, I won't go into
that. You don't want rigidity.
Right.
Yeah.
So the three bandha in their... let's say a slightly bigger picture, relating to what's called the three granti. And if you're going to talk about bandha, you need to have some understanding of what the three granti are. Granti is a knot. And the knot of the lower bandha is everything in relationship to your body, the food you put into your body, the style of practice that you're doing, and your attitude and relationship to the physical structures. And so Mullabhunga is said to be active when you no longer have any issues with money, food and sex.
Okay.
If you have any issues with money, food or sex, that knot is still tied on some level. And issues don't mean you don't have money, food or sex. It just means that you've started to resolve those lower level energy. So it means, you know, you could be poor and happy, you could be rich and happy, either, you know.
Yeah.
You're able to be in relationship with money that's very present-based, connected. Your relationship to the body. If you look at your body in the mirror, you don't go, oh, I wish I was taller, I wish I was skinnier, I wish I was more muscly. You have just a naturally loving relationship to the body. Your food that you put in for the body and also to nourish yourself, that there's no difficult relationship with that. What that means from a yogic point of view is one of the aspects of Mullabhunga is vegetarianism.
Right.
If you're not vegetarian, you cannot really access Mullabhunga, as far as I know. So that's just about conscious living, kindness again. You can't be eating meat and have Mullabhunga actually working, from what I gather. And each of the chakras, each of the bandhas and each of the granti are linked in these sort of pairs. So two chakras to each bandha, different levels of energy on each. Don't need to go into the details of every one, but... the idea then is Mullabhunga is just a very small starting point of awareness of how you are in relationship to this.
So this idea, squeezing your anus continually...
has got nothing to do with Mullabhunga.
Right.
Actually nothing to do with it. It directs your awareness into that area of your body. But it's not about physically doing something and then I get enlightened. That's cause and effect, which in terms of enlightenment doesn't exist. There is only cause. So if you're doing a practice for Mullabhunga, it's actually never going to be Mullabhunga. Mullabhunga has to be cause, which is being present with this, rather than making this do something. And if you're doing a technique for Mullabhunga, it's not Mullabhunga.
So is it a thing more of terminology rather than...
Yes, exactly. Yeah. It's just a language issue. Yeah. And I have nothing wrong with a teacher saying, oh, Mullabhunga... For asana, because what we're saying there is engage, lift or firm the pelvic floor muscles, you know, and all those little pieces that are connected in that. And that's hard enough for some people to go, you say pelvic floor or you say perineum and it's like,
where? Yeah, we're somewhere down there.
You know, and so that's enough of a subtlety to go, oh, I can, oh, is that my perineum? Wow. Or is for women, is that the cervix? Oh, interesting. And if you can touch on that part of your body, that's a really good, healthy starting point. But doing a constant action as some kind of... The other point around Mullabhunga that I disagree with is the idea that you have to hold the belly a certain way in Mullabhunga in order for something else bad, your back, to not get hurt.
Yeah.
And again, that's cause and effect, and it's problematic because it's taking the view that you have to do something, if it's extreme, in order to stop a bad thing from happening. Which is a very fear-based practice.
Yeah.
If habitually doing a lot of back bends causes a lot of pain in your back, yes, it may be that the somewhere in the abdomen is not so strong.
Yeah.
And so that can be something to look at, but it doesn't mean that then you start rigidly applying something else here, which later on causes, and I've had this happen to various students who've come to me, SI pain, SI problem.
Yes, yes.
From clenching the psoas area too much all
too
the time.
Much. Yeah.
And so the very thing you're trying to prevent, you actually cause by doing Mullabandha.
Yeah.
So it's just something to be a little, I just think, to be a bit light-hearted about it, not too forceful.
It seems to be the motto for everything, isn't it? We can so easily become too determined, too focused
right.
on one particular aspect or avenue.
Right. And, you know, and if the view of Mullabandha is only mostly a somatic, physically based, it's going to be a little bit limited. And that's okay as long as you can admit that.
Yeah.
And then you can say, oh, well, and then there's other areas that, whether you're experienced in it or not, whether you want to talk about chakras or psychology or high levels of meditation practice that hopefully help us towards opening up those other areas.
Cool. Thanks so much for your time. You know, hopefully we'll get to do this again in the future and cover some more stuff. And if you can see in the background, we're in the beautiful Bali at the moment. So, and Matthew's going to be running some retreats here. So look up his website and catch up with him.
All right.
That's cool. Thanks man.
Thanks, dude. All right. Shanti.